Well, we're going to be closing this study out eventually here, because we've just been actually reiterating a lot of the outline, you know, over and over and over. We're talking about justification and sanctification. But we started doing the incarnation, and incarnate means in the flesh, and that's what our Lord was. He was the God-man. And guess what? We have God in us now. We're sealed on the day of redemption, and we're walking on the flesh. Our deal is, though, we have different blood. He was tempted in all points as we, and you hear that this morning with my preaching, but he didn't sin, but he could have. And see, that's the big argument over perpetuity, but tough. But he didn't. He chose not to. So, think about that for a while. That'd drive me crazy. But he's God. How can he tempted in all points as we, but he didn't sin. It means he didn't obey the inclination to sin. It didn't. I'm telling you, he had to suffer all things. Did he go to hell? They'll argue about that too. But he did. Anyway, so what we're studying here is the Lord's inside of us. He wants to work outside of us. Through this flesh is how he does it. So, turn to John chapter 6. We'll cover some of these verses on incarnation. In John 6:57. As the living Father has sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, even he shall live by me. That's what Spurgeon says. Let's get this straight here so we get a definition of this. Okay. So in John 6:57, that's pretty close, man, to be able to eat him, right? That's where the Catholics get a lot of that stuff about Holy Eucharist and drinking the blood and stuff, but that is not what it means. Jesus Christ possessed a human physical nature as body, soul, and spirit. And we find that in some verses, and that's what we're going to go to next is these verses. Our text, though, is John 6:57. But the verses that we're concerned with today, so far, is you have Hebrews 2:14. And we'll read Hebrews 2:14 to 16. Incarnation, our Lord walking around the body. Amen. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself, speaking of the Lord, likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is, the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to what? Bondage. For verily he took not on, parentheses now, him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. You see that? Pretty simplistic, but it can be deep. So understand, though, that who had the power of death? The devil. And how was he able to do that? When he descended. He was on that cross. Remember? He was dropping them sins off. Went over there and snatched them keys. I like it. He's got them. We don't. And we can lay our head on our pillow. We're not subject to any fear. Shouldn't be. You know where you're going when you die, right? I mean, it's not that you're going to rush it, but I'm just saying, you don't stop every night before you go to bed, oh man, you know. I usually just flop my head, you know. Better than having the police looking for you, that guilty feeling all the time. Go to Matthew 26. We're just going through the incarnation, that body of Jesus, Jesus in the body. And Matthew 26:12, the Bible says, for in that she hath poured this ointment on my body, she did it for my burial. His recognition, which the disciples missed, if you remember when she did that, Judas was upset, and I'm sure other ones were too. all that money could have went to the poor. The Lord flat out told them. And that went over their head too. There's a whole lot of things that the disciples didn't catch on to. And in Luke 23:46. Well, I didn't get a call from my wife either, a text that I could see. It says, and when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the what? Ghost. What are you seeing here? I'm seeing the God-man, body, soul, and spirit. Luke 24:39. Luke 24:39. Behold my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit hath not flesh and bones, as you see me have. Since I did that study with the blood, you know, every time I see the Lord, it doesn't mention blood, just flesh and bones. Interesting. So you have this incarnation. Our Lord walked around body, soul, and spirit. And the purpose of the incarnation, as we know from past studies, and we're going to cover some verses again, the purpose of the incarnation is the atonement. The atonement. Him coming and bringing God the Father and man together. That atonement. Something had to take place. He had to take place. And the problem with when he was here and the problem with people now is the fact that they fail to recognize God manifest in the flesh. And a lot of them will recognize some changes and different things in people, but they don't recognize that God's doing it. They just say, you turn over a new leaf. They say, no, you don't. No, I didn't, baby. This is God. Miracle of God. And some of them say, well, that's good enough for you, but it wouldn't work on me. That kind of thing. Everybody's shifting responsibility that's lost, or they don't want to take accountability for who they are. And that's why everybody goes and finds a different religion, and now they got the religion of what? Communism? Yeah. It's a religion, man. But anyway, John chapter 7. John chapter 7 and verse 1. Now, Lord knows we probably went through this earlier studying because of the columns that we covered. But like I said, it's just reiteration. Over here in John 7:1, it says, after these things, Jesus walked in Galilee, for he would not walk in Jewry. Why? Because the Jews sought to kill him. So here, the purpose of the atonement, you got the Lamb of God walking around, and who was meant for? The Jewish people. Yeah. And they rejected it. They didn't see it. And you go to John chapter, if you're still in John chapter 7, is it somebody? Read verse 7. Okay, John 8 and verse 18, and it looks like 19. John 8, 18 and 19. I am one that bears witness of myself, and the Father that sent me beareth witness of me. Then said they unto him, where is thy Father? Jesus answered, ye neither know me nor my Father. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. Good verses, man. Well, it's all good verses. We're talking about that incarnation, and the whole purpose was the atonement. Go to Isaiah 9 and verse 6. Isaiah 9, 6. And then if you ever want to get a real panoramic view, you go to Isaiah 53 and 54, both chapters, and you read them slowly, and maybe something will take place. Isaiah 9:6, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Who's that? This child. This son that was given, Lord Jesus Christ. And because of that accomplishment, he goes back up yonder where he came from. But this time, the whole world, that was his footstool, right? Now he conquers when he comes back, sets up shop. And I'm telling you, we're going to be known as we're known. That's going to be some kind of a trippy thing. Luke chapter 1 and 32, the virgin birth was by the Spirit. Still working on the body, soul, and spirit here. Still working about the incarnation. Still talking about the incarnation of Christ. And in Luke 1:32, the Bible says, he shall be great, shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. See, simple, simplistic faith in a verse like that tells you the Lord ain't going away. He's here forever. He was here from forever before. I mean, he's got no beginning, no end. And because of this, what he has done, we're involved in it now. He allowed us to be involved in it. Pretty heavy. Over here in chapter 1, that was verse 32 and 33. Verse 35 of chapter 1 says, and the angel answered and said unto her, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee. Not a German soldier. Not some... Anyway, all the different things they say. And it says, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And then Luke 1 again in verse 46 says, and Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God. And she calls him what? My Savior. So the Virgin Mary called Jesus her Savior. Why? Because he's the Savior of the world. I mean, what kind of blood she got going through her veins? Adam's? Then we see that the Father gave Christ the body. What? We're back with the children partakers. Hebrews 2:14. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, look what it says, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil. And Hebrews 4:15, for we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted, like as we are, yet without sin. So we're noticing about this body, we're noticing about the Holy Spirit. Then he goes on to tell you about that body being a temple, the temple of the Holy Ghost. John 2:19. Keep my call. John 2:19. Jesus answered and said unto them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. You know, he's talking about his flesh. In 1 Timothy 3:16. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. He was justified in the spirit. Seen angels. Preached unto the Gentiles. Believed on in the world. Received on the glory. Seen of angels, yeah, one particular place. Remember after temptation? Matthew there, the angels came and got him. And then also the Bible expressly says the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We know that in the Gospel of John. We know that, let's see, he was born in Bethlehem, means bread for sure. And one word fulfills the law, and that word is Christ. We know that. Let's see what else here. In 1 John 1:1, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. Wow. Bless you. Micah 5:2. Micah 5:2. But thou, Bethlehem, Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is to be ruler in Israel, whose going forth have been from old, from everlasting. It's like the prophecy verses I love. And all the way back to Galatians 5:4. Are you writing all this down, Lily? You got this down? Amen. No sleeping. Galatians 5:4. Christ has become of no effect on you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, ye are fallen from grace. For we, through the Spirit, wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. Faith, 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 faith. So, definitely, one word again, fulfills the law, and that's Christ. Talking about that atonement. I mean, he fulfills everything. Says he fulfilled the scriptures. Yeah, man. And the Son of God becomes the Son of Man. We know that through the virgin birth, Isaiah 7:14. Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive, bear a son, shall call his name Emmanuel. And then we also understand that the resurrection results when body is destroyed, proving life after death. And 1 Corinthians 15 goes into the first fruits and so on. Ephesians 4, let's see. And I'll skip this page. So that's the incarnate Christ walking around, body, soul, and spirit, doing the will of his Father. And then we understand about the indwelling, which would be the right side of the chart, which we did before, which you're going to get a copy of. I got probably 20 pages, and we got a little church, so maybe I can do all that for you guys. Because these kinds of studies are, you forget. You get it when you hear it, write it down, say, yeah, that's right. But until you experience some of this stuff, it's just like temptation. There's no temptation is taking you such as common to man. Who's going to provide a way? God is. Well, how many times do you trip up with that stuff and you don't find another way? You don't bother to even think in your mind about the verse. You don't look for a way out. How many times do Christians do that? Over and over, thousands, millions maybe. Then finally it dawns on them, experience. They say, temptation's so great. Lord, and boom, something will happen. Maybe a phone call, maybe something. You need to say, that's it. And get your mind off it enough where the temptation will wane down. And that's called experience. So when you teach it and preach it, then you say, yeah, I've done that a few times. Prove that verse right. And that's life as a Christian. There's a ton of verses in here. I mean, it's just so surreal when you think about you're separated from when you're looking at yourself. Wow. Parts in heaven, other parts down here. Weird, man. You know, but it's true. Just believe God. You have to understand, you believe God, what he says. He lets us understand the things that we need to, that's for sure. So the indwelling deals with our character and our conduct. What God does in us. Indwelling commences at the second birth, when you were saved. Justification is our standing, that's our positional. And sanctification is our state, our practical. So I got to remember, yeah, I'm saved forever. Yeah, I'm already seated in heavenly place in Christ Jesus, but I'm stuck in this stinking body of death right now. So what do I do? Well, you can do like a lot of Calvinists and everything else. They don't do nothing. They just study the Bible. They claim Bereans. You know, they just study the Bible daily. And the problem with all that, there's no practical living. They don't apply none of that because they don't believe in the standing and state. Therefore, it's really whacked out with the judgment seat of Christ. There's so much, and then people just suck that in. Anyway, you're living on planet Earth, so what now? You live just like everybody else. Well, positionally, you're above everybody else in heaven. So somehow that's got to get down here and be applicable to everybody else around you so they know that you got something they ain't got. And then they come out with, what was that, lifestyle conversion? Anyway, the big deal, the big move was you don't have to go around and give out tracts. Do that. It's a little Calvinistic. If I act like Christ and what would Christ do and all this stuff, then it will get people saved. Yeah, that's some of that's application true. Yeah, you're supposed to do both. Because you got verses for both in the Pauline epistles. You know, you're going to give an answer to all the hope that lies within you, right? That means you're going to have to know doctrine. And the Bible says they're going to do what? They're going to shun doctrine last days. They're going to heap to themselves teachers having itch in ears. They don't even want preaching. Oh, yeah, well, your church, your guy gets up there and he just yells and this other guy relates. You know? No, because what he's yelling, you can hear clearly. And you got to change. You can go somewhere else and learn all the stuff you want, be an airhead, and not change. I mean, that's... I'm telling you, I'm sitting back watching the gun issue, which eventually is going to be a mental issue. And they're going to try their best to try to get that Second Amendment overruled by mental capacity and special insurance you're going to have, which nobody can afford on themselves if they carry a gun. I mean, I'm seeing all this stuff come up. I'm saying, see, this diabolical thing is moving everything. Thousands of different things are going at one time. It's hard to, especially when you got some punk Republicans that ain't doing their job. I mean, we could have had 37 investigations already going right now, legally. Could have already impeached these people. Could have already got Pelosi out of there for violating her oath. You know how many people violated their oath? Tons of them. Where the godly man ceases. Remember that? You go to Psalms chapter 12, you start looking at the Word of God where all, it's emphasized it's in the midst of all that junk going on. So here we got Christ in us, the hope of glory, and people don't even recognize that by Scripture. Some of them are still confused. They'll read some of these Scriptures, they can't figure it out, really? Okay, purpose of the indwelling abiding Spirit is separation or dedication unto God. And the believers... fail to recognize the Holy Ghost manifest in their flesh. What happens when that happens? Well, lovers of your pleasure more than lovers of God. Go to 1 Corinthians 2:12. There's a ton of verses I have in here, but we covered so much of it that we're going to have to go to a different study. I'll try to think of a good one. 1 Corinthians 2:12. The Bible says, now we have received not the spirit, little s, of the world, but the spirit, little s, which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us of who? God. That action of the spirit. Everybody was born with the spirit, right? God gave light to everybody, right, when they were born? Remember that? I think we covered some of that. But everybody's got a spirit. Problem is, it's dead till it gets born again. It's dead unto God. And people miss that. Well, then, I guess they don't have a spirit. No, you got a spirit, but it's dead unto God. Meaning that you're just not going to stop and say, oh, God, how you doing? Everything, you know, everything. Now, you can do that like Cornelius, maybe in a certain position, and God can recognize that and send somebody to you to lead you to the Lord. But I'm telling you, until you get God in there to quicken that spirit, you're not together. You're not on his team yet. But you do have a spirit. Display that every time in a hockey game, basketball game, football game. Where's the team spirit? Go by a bar. Beer and spirits. We had a Tiger Town bar on Michigan Avenue. It said the bar with all the friendly spirits. And them old Irish people be fighting in there all the time. Friendly spirits. Anyway, to know the things that are freely given of God, you got to have his spirit. And if you're saved here, you almost know before you do stuff wrong, don't you? I mean, even a person that's not saved, they got that conscience to begin with, and it was never seared or taught out of them. They know the difference between good and right. There's the difference between good and wrong. Right and wrong. Yeah, they do. And if they choose to do the wrong all the time, guess what happens? Pretty soon the right is not there. That's just exercising their conscience as a lost person. But a saved person? Well, God can remove a whole lot of things, but I think part of the torture is know you're doing wrong, and you should have did right, and you didn't do right. A Christian, I mean, you can torture yourself by doing all the junk that you don't need to do. And the only way back is the way back. It's called sorry. How many times you gotta do that? I don't think there's a book written that's got them all in there, answers all that. I just know everybody else sins the same with just unique personalities, unique ways that we can rearrange sin or whatever, but just repent. Say you're sorry. Best thing I know about doing. But that is some of the purpose of the Holy Spirit being inside of you. You communicate with God, God communicates with you. We know that the second birth is definitely by the Spirit. And in Ephesians 3:17, the Bible says that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that ye being rooted and grounded in love. And I don't have the rest of the verse on this thing. It's got to be more than grounded in love. What's the remainder of that for the comma? Anybody got it? Ephesians 3:17, I'm sorry. That's got to do with what Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. And Ephesians 4:30, the Bible says, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, wherein ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. What are you showing, preacher? I showed you how the incarnate, we're in that body. Now I'm trying to show you some indwelling of the Spirit, what takes place. Galatians 4:19 says, my little children, of whom I travail in birth again unto Christ, be formed in you. Baby Christians, what is Paul saying? You can't wait till Christ is formed in you. You're mature, that you can mature. You're no longer carnal, you're no longer babes, but you're mature in the Lord. And in order to have Christ formed in you, that's part of the recognition of who you are on the inside, part of your identity. Nobody's teaching this. It's too deep. It takes too long. You know, you tell a little kid you're saved, that means Jesus is in your heart. That's good for a while. But then eventually you got to explain the emotions that they're going through. And you can keep saying it's because Jesus is in your heart. You know, just so they understand. Light bulbs going up. But a lot of that's not covered anymore in anything. In Matthew 15, all the way in Matthew 15, verse 28. And I like it when the Lord's moving towards them Gentiles, amen. The Bible says, then Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. And Jesus departed from thence, came nigh unto the Sea of Galilee, and went up into a mountain and sat down there. Got to do with belief. Belief, belief, belief. The devil can get you skeptical. How can you have belief? You can't. Your mind's going another direction. And the believer's body is dwelt by the Holy Ghost. We understand that. 1 Corinthians 12:27. Now ye are the body of Christ and members in particular. I like that word, in particular, because that means we're not all cookie-cutted. We all got our personalities and little quirks and everything. God knows what it is. If you're saved, you're in the body, period. and God uses that, whoever the particulars are. He uses them as he sees fit. And then the good old multiplication thing, you got, if you read Ephesians 1, 13 and 14, you get the complete thing. But in 13 it says, in whom he also trusted. How'd you trust? After that you heard the word of truth. Okay, heard it. What was the word of truth? What did it have to do? The gospel of your salvation. So somewhere along the line, somebody said death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, right? Somehow I got that message. The word of truth. In whom also that ye believed. So, you trusted something. What'd you trust? What you heard? What'd you hear? The gospel. And what'd you do? You believed it. And what happened to you? You were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. And 14 is in this paragraph. Which is the earnest of our inheritance unto the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. In other words, we got the down payment. We're just as good as there already. Positionally speaking, we're already up in heavenly places. Eventually, that rapture is going to happen. We're going to be joined with a glorified body. Amen. Because we're members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones, according to Ephesians 5:30. And we definitely know that the believer wasn't born again or made with hands. That's for sure. Acts 7:48 is a good verse for that. Acts 7:48. The Bible says, howbeit the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands, as saith the prophet. Heaven is my throne, and earth is my footstool. What house will you build me, saith the Lord, or what is the place of my rest? That's the question now you can think about for a long time. You know, why make your physical house as clean as you can as a testimony for the Lord? I mean, well, because you don't find him dwelling in evil places. You don't find God dwelling there. Now, it doesn't mean he's not aware of stuff like that. And it doesn't mean he won't find a backslider that goes into a house of ill repute or whatever and work on him. But that ain't where he goes. But he does go and he does enter in places that were made with hands. If you remember Solomon's temple, remember he wouldn't let David even lay one hammer to anything because he was a bloody man because of Uriah the Hittite. But yet, he allowed David, by his mercy and grace, to be able to bring a collection and bring money into it. And he told Israel, build me a house. So it's not a contradiction, it's just a place he meets. But just interesting stuff when you think about it. What house will you build me, saith the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? In other words, a permanent address. 2 Corinthians 6:16 says this, and what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And we know that the word of God does something in the believer. 2 Peter 1:4, whereby are you given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. John 6:63 says, it is the spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. And where's those words now? King James Bible. Why is it important to keep reading it every day? Because they're spirit and they're life. But when you don't, it seems like you're going the opposite way. Immediately, almost. And we know that through that power of God, that normal sons of men become sons of God. And, John 1:12, about the power of God, not just authority, but he's given us the power to become the sons of God. And it's interesting, it doesn't say repent, but it says believe on his name, right? Belief, the heart action, exercises the will. That's what God's looking at. He's not looking at your brain and all your little intricacies. He's looking at a heart belief. A lot of people miss that. And then also, in 2 Corinthians 5:6, therefore we are always confident, knowing that whilst we were at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. That ought to be our attitude. Finally, you get a lot of life behind you, you're saying, yep, exactly. Why are you hanging around? For somebody else? See some of your prayers answered? Be encouraged in the Lord? 2 Corinthians 5:6 says, therefore, 2 Corinthians 5:6, therefore, we are always confident, knowing that whilst we were at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord, once again. And this is what we need to understand. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Then it goes on after that and says, we are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. If you understand walking by faith and not by sight, you will get confident in the Lord. Why? Because he's going to provide for you. He will provide for you. And when you keep seeing that happen over and over again, you know what you do? You got confidence. Your faith grows because he allows it to grow. He allows it to grow because you believe. You're just hanging in there. You're taking a verse and hanging with it. And then, of course, all of our invitations for this study would be Romans 12:1-2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, they present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and accept the perfect will of God. Somebody says you can't know the will of God. Well, just do them verses. Besides that, there's enough verses that says this is the will of God in Christ Jesus. There's a ton of verses in there. I believe what we'll do is next Sunday will be it, and we will cover a man of sorrows. Talking about the Lord Jesus Christ, since we're talking about walking by faith, since we're talking about walking by the Spirit, not fulfilling the lust of the flesh, since we're talking about the Lord working through us, you need to understand he was a man of sorrows. And so, today's what, 26th? So, what would it be, the 3rd of November or something next Sunday? I mean October.